And now, The Rock Newman Show.
Folks, we're back. Today, Saturday, November the 23rd, 2013. And I want to jump right in with our next guest. His name is Karamu Kush. Karamu, we have about 15 minutes, and I wish we had 2 hours because there's a lot we could talk about. You are a writer, a director, an actor. You come back to Howard University. Now, do you, when you come back to Howard University, do you come and you teach some courses there?
I'm a professor at Howard.
You're actually you're actually a professor at Howard University in what department?
I'm in the theater arts department.
And what do you teach?
I teach acting for TV and film.
Howard has a great history.
Yeah. You went to Howard, right?
Absolutely. See? Absolutely. I love Howard University. Debbie Allen.
Yeah, Felicia Rashad.
Felicia Rashad. Roberta Flack.
Yeah.
Donny Hathaway.
Donny Hathaway, Ossie Davis.
Ossie Davis, the Blackbird, Donald Byrd, and Donald Byrd and the Blackbird. Great, great history. And look, recently, now, let me draw a blank here now, but the sister who was in Hustle and Flow.
Well,
first of all, Taraji Henson, Paula Parker,
right?
Anthony Anderson,
Wayans,
the Wayans brothers, the brother who played Jackie Robinson,
Isaiah Washington.
Now, how long have you been teaching? Did you teach any of them?
No. I'm younger than all of them.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah. This is my second year teaching. I actually filled in the position that was formerly by Al Freeman Jr.
The late Al Freeman, absolutely.
His role in Malcolm X playing Elijah Muhammad.
Yes.
I really believe that the majority of people in the world who might not have been familiar with Elijah Muhammad, when they think of Elijah Muhammad, now they think of Al Freeman.
Well, you know, it was overlooked, I think, in terms of an Academy Award because people didn't really know, or they don't really know who Elijah was or how he was.
Yeah.
And to see Al Freeman transform the way he did was bananas, you know. But, I mean, that's just a classic case of cultural ignorance, I guess, just not knowing about that man and all his wonderful achievement.
You know, out there are parents who have children.
Yeah.
That say, look at kids on television saying, that's what I want to do. Mm-hmm. When a kid says that to a parent, your advice to that parent is what?
Create as many opportunities as possible to put that kid in that environment, you know, be it local community theater or be it school theater, really just feed that desire. I mean, I think that's one of the greatest things that a parent can do is afford a child's dreams, you know, so.
Yeah. You have a couple of movies that you've done. You've done several things.
Yeah.
And then.
Yeah, that's an interesting one.
there's a little something called "And Then."
Yeah.
Folks, if you have not heard of it, Google it. Google this man here, Karamu Kush. Karamu Kush.
Yeah.
And Google "And Then." Tell us what inspired you to do that and what that experience was like getting that done.
Well, in short, it's a piece that was co-written by Aisha Hines, a well-known actress, and myself. And it won a screenwriting award for Shadow and Act. It's an online, it's like the preeminent independent black film blog, and it's on the IndieWire network. And we won the award to made the film. The film really took off pretty strong, and it's still going. It's like averaging like 80 hits a day online. It's got like about 12,000 hits so far. You know, I mean, that's a lot for a short film that's half hour long. I mean, typically, you know, shorter films get that kind of look, but you know, to be a half an hour and online, it's saying that people are watching and paying attention, you know, so it's really nice.
Where did you grow up?
Detroit, Michigan.
What drew you to this field?
I kind of came through the back door. I mean, I've always been like culturally informed and aware and conscious and concerned, you know.
Where did that come from?
My parents, my grandfather, my mother, my family. And I was actually growing to be a politician. It's interesting because you're doing the whole campaign thing with the brother who runs the Busboys and Poets. But I was planning on being a politician. Mm-hmm. And I got a little disenfranchised with the whole electoral college and that whole just thing, you know, how politics go. It's just part of the game. And I just discovered the arts after playing sports And that just moved me. You know, I realized it was a direct conversation happening between me and the audience. And that just, you know, I was like, this is my thing right here.
Now, was there someone that grabbed you, that inspired you?
Yeah, Woody King Jr. He's like probably the preeminent producer of black theater in the history of American theater. And people like Al Freeman, you know, reading about them, studying about them. Dick Anthony Williams, you know, a lot of old school legends in the black theater. Negro Ensemble Company, places like that really inspired me a whole lot and informed my move to New York and my pursuit of the arts. Mm-hmm. So.
And as a, do you have, again, writer, director, actor,
yeah.
Is one your greatest calling or is it all a part of who you are?
It's all a part. I mean, I think it's really incumbent upon us as arts creators to really be more than just actors. You know, I don't think we have the luxury to just be actors. At least personally, I don't believe I have the luxury to just be an actor. I think it's really important to create stories and embed those stories with our concerns with culture, you know. So, it's kind of like children. You can't just choose one over the other. It's like they all kind of have a special place in your heart, you know, and they tell you what they need, you know, and you just respond, so.
Yeah. I've had some times in my life where I spent a lot of time up at 42nd Street and 6th Avenue in the offices of HBO.
Okay.
Pretty powerful organization,
yes,
Time Warner there.
Yeah.
You have something called Salvation Road.
Yeah, yeah.
And there's an association with HBO. Tell us about
that. Yeah, that's my AFI thesis film. I went to AFI for film school, grad film school. And upon coming out, I did a thesis film called Salvation Road. It actually features Russell Hornsby, who's on this TV show Grimm, mm-hmm. on NBC right now, and also the great Roger Guinevere Smith, who was in a gang of Spike Lee's projects. He's like part of that whole Spike ensemble. And then it's a wonderful actor named Michael J. Harney. He's actually on a TV, well, not TV show, but it's the Netflix series now called Orange is the New Black. So we had a really nice cast, you know, and the film did good. It got the DGA Award, it got Caucus Foundation Award, and got picked up by HBO after going to the American Black Film Festival.
What's the subject, man?
It's about that film was about a hitman who is witnessed executing his traitor's mentor by a 9-year-old boy, and what he does with that boy after the fact, because he's been witnessed doing this crime, so.
You know, not so long ago, I had a group here at this table.
Okay.
It was led by a comedian named Mike Brooks. He is from Washington, D.C.
Mm-hmm.
He has what is, in essence, a parody. It's called The Housewives of Benning Road.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Benning Road is in the hood,
okay.
here in D.C. And he really creates a caricature of much of the life in the hood.
Okay.
And to put it mildly, it's been extremely popular. I mean, he's now surpassed, but he probably now has a couple of million views,
wow.
of his various series.
Yeah, yeah.
At the same time, he's come under tremendous criticism
mm.
for the characterization of black men and women,
right,
and,
right.
And you know, the buffoonery of creating the character.
Right, right.
His position is, this is satire. I'm a comedian, and
mm-hmm.
and I've got a right to do this.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not trying to denigrate the community. What's your feelings about something like that?
Well, you know, when people respond like that to material, it's because of a lack of options. You know, I mean, we're certainly not, we got more than enough comedy, you know. And I mean, you could say that's probably the easy sell oftentimes. And I mean, folks who are responding to it, they're upset because they're not seeing the balance. They're not seeing, you know, the dramas. They're not seeing the historical pieces that really speak to us in our totality, you know. So, I mean, like even the work I do, I mean, I tend to focus on women's stories,
mm-hmm.
and relationships with them. Black folk, you know, so I mean, and it's not as easy to get those kind of things done as it is to get some pieces done where you just want folks to laugh and have a good time, you know. But I think he has a right to do it just like anybody else does. Mm-hmm.
He's a local guy that's trying to, you know, cross over and become a big guy.
Yeah, yeah.
Tyler Perry.
Yeah, I was about to say Tyler Perry.
Perry has blown up.
Yeah.
Just absolutely blown up, making a whole bunch of money. Mm-hmm. So in part controlling his own destiny, which is the dream of
many
in the community that hadn't had the kind of opportunities to be able to control your own destiny.
Mm-hmm.
That's Tyler Perry.
Mm-hmm.
People like his stuff, and they go and they support his stuff.
That's right.
He comes under harsh criticism from mm-hmm. Spike Lee.
Mm-hmm.
Your thoughts?
Well, Tyler's making a bunch of money. Whenever you're making a bunch of money, you're an easy target, you know. I think Spike has a right to express his opinion about it, and I mean, a large part of it may be valid and true. But I mean, again, it's the classic case of us having a lot of this thing over here and so little of this thing over there, and that's where I guess the resentment comes into play.
Yeah,
you know.
As a writer, as an actor, as a director,
mm-hmm.
I want to share with you that I was moved in a very big way by the movie 12 Years a Slave.
Mm-hmm.
I suggested on my Facebook page that I wish every American, black and white, could see that movie. I thought that it was something in it that they could all get from it.
Right.
There was a prolific use of the word nigger.
Right.
People complained about that. How do you feel about the movie, and how do you feel about that, the word nigger being used so much in that movie, and also in Django, and Quentin Tarantino.
Right. Django.
Yeah, Django. Yeah. Yeah. What did I say?
You said Django.
Django.
That's all right, though. It's still Django.
Yeah.
I often say I ain't got no problem with niggas, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Niggas ain't never done me no harm, it's, you know. Or the word nigga ain't never done me no harm, you know. It's niggas that done me harm. White niggas, black niggas, you know. But it's a word, man. I mean, my generation deals with the word differently anyway, and it's not to discount what has happened with the word before us and all the implications, you know. But I ain't got no problem with it, personally. In terms of, you asked about 12 Years a Slave, it's interesting because I'm honestly not the biggest fan of the film. You know, I appreciate the filmmaking, I appreciate the artistry, but if anything, the thing that bothers me about the film is the deeper message that's coming across, which is basically you got this main character, this protagonist who seemingly cares about nobody and nothing but himself. And that's really problematic for me. I mean, even in terms of the women he encounters while he's enslaved. I mean, even that character Patsy, right? Yeah. It's like that. I had huge issues and problems with the fact that he did nothing or his service to her, his responsibility to her was pretty much non-existent, you know what I mean? But that's just me, you know, that's my feelings about it. And I can go on and on about it, but I mean, you know, Steve McQueen's a wonderful filmmaker, he's an artist.
Yeah.
You know, he's from the art world, so I mean, that's what you got. You got an art film that used slavery as inspiration. And that's, just, again, his right to create that film also. But I mean, for my money, I prefer the Gordon Parks version.
Yeah.
Of 12 Years a Slave. Yeah. People don't know about that.
Yeah.
You know, in terms of Gordon Parks making that film back in 84. You know,
what a talent, Gordon Parks.
Oh my God!
Man, right on my coffee table. My wife loves Gordon Parks.
I personally wish that Steve McQueen had probably spent some time with Gordon Parks' piece if he hadn't. I mean, he said his wife brought it to him. I'm like, well, you know, Doug, why don't you go look at Gordon's work and really glean from that? I think it's like even you talking about the word nigga. I couldn't deal with that word and not be aware of the history and the context and all this transpired before hip hop got a hold of it and attempted to, I guess, reform the word in some kind of way. For me to not acknowledge that is crazy, you know, so.
What, you know, as we wrap up here, we've got a minute left.
Yeah.
Your aspirations as a young artist?
To make more stories about relationships, in particular with black men and black women, and heal us in as many ways as possible.
That's a lofty goal.
That's a lot to go.
I mean, we got to reach, right?
Okay. And I got to have you back, man. We have a lot more time to talk. Thank you so much for joining us here today.
Thank you.
Folks, we'll be back in the 10 o'clock hour. We'll talk to Sophia Stewart, referred to as the mother of the Matrix. Talk to her about her case against Hollywood, Warner Brothers, her claim that the story was lifted from her manuscript.